Okay, so we're going to now put the compassionate self to work. So what I'd like you to do is to take a piece of paper. And draw it into quarters. Put it into quarters. That's it. Put it into quarters. And then down the side of the first square in the top right and top left hand. Okay, we're going to put four things. Thoughts, then body, then actions, and then memories. All right. So you're going to, because you're going to write in these things. So, you know, equidistant from each other, it's going into the inner box. Thoughts, actions, and memories. Okay. He likes this one. Jotun likes this one. He likes this one. Yeah, in each box is going to be, oh yeah, each box is going to have the same. It's going to have the same. So it's going to be, for each box, there's going to be thoughts, body, actions, and memories. And every single box will have the same four things. Right. Okay, so here we go. We're going to do a demonstration of what we call multiple selves. Now, I'm going to do it with you as a group, right? So go at a pace that you're comfortable with, right? Okay, so if it disturbs you slightly, then pull out of it, okay? This is guided discovery, good old guided discovery. And we use a lot of Socratic questions here. Socratic questions are the kind of the real skill, actually, of many therapies. Okay, so I would like you to, we're going to start off by understanding that when we respond to things that are frightening to us, we can respond in multiple ways. And these multiple ways are quite interesting. So I'd like you to think of an argument that you've had with somebody you care about. So bring that to mind. Okay, can you remember that? I know you're all compassionate people, so it's a very rare event, but all right, have you got that in mind? Okay, now then, we're going to go a little guided tour of your system. So I'd like you just to focus on your angry self, that part of you that was angry about this argument or in this argument. So first of all, write down, what were your thoughts? What were you thinking? What was angry self thinking? Okay, that's great. We don't have a lot of time for this, so I'm going to hurry you along. So, and the second thing is then, what does anger feel like in your body? Where is it in your body? And the second Socratic question is, if that anger was to build and become more and more intense, where would it go? Now, when you do this with patients, you spend time exploring it with them. Where is it? Can you show me? Can you describe it? And if it gets more, can you take that posture? Okay, so you do quite a lot of more in detailed work. This is only to give you a flavor. Okay, so we know what angry self thinks, we know what angry self feels in the body, and if anger builds, we know how that feels too. So the next thing is, if angry self was control, or angry mind, whichever you want to call it, was in control of your actions, what would it do? Didn't have any other concerns, it's just going to do what it wants to do. What would angry self do? okay? And lastly, when you are in contact with anger, what memories come to mind? These may be memories of you being angry, but not necessarily. It could be just think about anger. What memories come to mind? Okay, just make a note of that. Okay, so now you're beginning to visit angry self. You know what angry self thinks. You know what angry self feels like in the body. You know the kind of things angry self wants to do. And angry self has its own memories. Now, anger, you're looking for three basic responses for anger. One is lashing out, shouting, right up to hitting. The other is cut off, which is storming out. I've had enough of you, I'm out of here. So it's cut, we call that cut off. And the other is passive aggressive. I'm not going to get you today, but I'll get you tomorrow. I'll be nice today and submissive, but tomorrow. Okay, so people are upset in companies, the passive aggressives, watch out, because they will sabotage you. The people who can't talk about the things that they're angry about and so on. Oh, I've got bubbles, never mind. okay, so take a breath and say, thank you very much, angry self, for coming and talking to us this afternoon. That's kind of interesting. And now bring back that memory of the argument, but this time, focus on the part of you that was very anxious, or perhaps it wasn't very anxious, but the part of you that was anxious. That if you could imagine the anxious part of you having arguments, just turn your attention to the anxiety aspect of it, right? What does anxious self think about this argument? Okay, and again, I do sincerely apologize for rushing you through this. What is that anxiety feel in your body? When you feel the anxiety that can come when you're in an argument, what does that feel like in your body? And remember, my second question always is, if that anxiety built and became more and more intense, where would it go and what would it feel like? And then, the actions. What would anxiety self want to do? If anxiety controlled the game and you, what would anxiety do? What would you be doing if you were controlled by anxious self? What does anxious self want to do? Okay, and lastly, when you get into anxious self, what memories come to mind? Okay, that's wonderful. So just say, take a breath and say, thank you very much, anxious self, for coming along and talking to me today and revealing things. And now we're going to focus on, in the bottom left-hand quadrant, the sad self. So the part of you that's sad about this argument. What does the sad part of you think? Okay, and the next question is, of course, how does sadness feel in your body? Where is it? What's the sensations of sadness in your body? If sadness became more intense and built, what would that feel like? And if sadness was in control of your actions, what would sadness do? What would you do if sadness was in control? What are the actions of sadness? And finally, memories. When you're in sad self, right, what memories come to mind? Okay, mon ami. So, we're going to look at another self in a moment, which you can probably imagine what that's going to be. But before we do that, what have you noticed?
If you didn't remind us to take a breath, that I really do.
Yes, take the breath, let go. That's very important in between the different things. Yeah. Ricardo.
A lot of the memories were from childhood.
Yeah. It's interesting, isn't it? A lot of the memories were from childhood. Yeah.
I noticed that anger was directed at someone else, but anxiety and sadness was directed at myself.
Okay. So there's different directions, okay?
A lot of the same body feelings were the same.
A lot of the body feelings was sadness. Does sadness feel the same as anger?
A little bit. Not totally, but.
Okay. Okay, that's interesting. Okay. Yeah?
I couldn't tell if my changing posture was affecting my thoughts or if my thoughts were changing my posture.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Anything? Yeah.
I was going to say, there's some kind of story that I I just completely came into it, especially with the memory. Like, I have a particular story or a way of seeing it from that side.
Which is different.
Which is different.
In each case.
So what I hope you've discovered, and Ricardo kind of pointed this out, is that you think differently. Your bodily experiences usually are different. Sadness is a kind of collapsing inwards of the self. And if you do depression, right, it's quite useful to do sad self and depressed self and help them realize these are quite different selves. Because depressed self collapses and is not sad. It's kind of a hopeless. Sadness is more of an active state of the ability to grieve and cry. But this is a more technical point. So with depressed people, you always separate out these selves. Okay, so they think differently, right? They feel differently in the body. They want to do different things. And do any of you notice they're different memories? Oh my God! You're all multiples. All right. So the point about it is, you can do this stuff, and probably most of you are aware of this, sort of, that when you get into an argument, when something goes wrong, there are different parts of your gearing up. Now then, a couple of things is, which one of these three tends to be the dominant one in which you respond with arguments? Anger? Anxiety? Some of you will have sadness. So there's a dominant self, right? And remember this morning we were talking about how one emotion blocks out another, in your patients one will block out another. So in borderlines, angry self will always turn up, right? They're the ones that will, and then they'll cut and everything. The crying and sadness, they don't do. Depressed people are very, they don't do any of that. They just go into sadness and anxiety and into depression. So these different selves... thing. Now the next thing, sorry, yeah.
What about the notion of public self and private self in each of these scenarios? Because there's the, you know, what you might project out in each case and what you're doing inside.
Okay, that's a fabulous point. So that's a more technical point. So yes, you have to make it more complex. But of course you're absolutely right. This is a brilliant question. So the issue is, the question was, what about a presentation and an inwardly active thing? And you're absolutely right. How do you want to present yourself? So, for example, if your boss criticizes you, right, there might be a part of you that's feeling quite angry, quite a view that's anxious because you don't want to lose your job, and a part of you that's sad because you were trying very hard. But your presentation is to be at poise. Oh, I see. I can see you're unhappy with my work. Don't worry, I shall take it away, and I shall fix it immediately. Thank you so much for pointing out my errors. So that's important. So that's important. So the issue of poison presentation, or in people who are very aggressive, particularly young guys, the presentation of the tough, fearless self becomes very important, and that's part of it. Even though they might be feeling very anxious inside, the presentation is this way. So those are really, really, really important thoughts. And of course, the patients may be presenting you with one aspect where actually they're feeling something else sitting there, you know, whatever. So very, very excellent point. Yeah. But if you just keep it simple again. So what you've discovered then is these different selves within you, and all you need to do really is to help the patient by isolating them. And when you get into this, you can put them on separate chairs. The only thing I would say to you is be careful of leakage, right? So sometimes with depressed people, they start to talk about anger and they'll start crying. You just say, okay, well, happy to talk to sad self, but not in this chair or not at this point, right? Take a breath. Let's get back into the anger. Oh, I don't like anger. I never liked anger. Hold it. Okay. Then if you need to move them into sad chair, move them into sad chair, but don't let leakage between the cells, because then you lose the point of the exercise. Now, the next question to ask you is, what does angry self think of anxious self? They don't get along to that.
Be a little embarrassed at the weakness.
Yes. They don't like the weakness. Okay, and what does anxious self think and feel about angry self? Yeah. oh my God, if you do this, then oh my God, you're gonna get this in serious trouble. So Laurel and Hardy is, oh my God, not unless you come here. Now the thing is, we can talk about this because relatively speaking, you'll be pretty familiar at an intuitive level with multiple selves. And if I was to say to you, if you were to come to say to me, look, I had an argument with my partner last night, and I was kind of annoyed about that, but there's another part of me that was really upset about it because I didn't want it, and it just came out of nowhere. And I was really quite sad, and I went home and cried. And you'd be able to talk about multiple selves. Borderlines cannot. They haven't really got much of an idea of this thing. So they just blow fuses. They have no way of talking about multiples within themselves. And this part of me feels this, and this part of me feels that. But this is quite important, because what we often do with our borderlines is when there's a blow-up, we actually ask them, okay, I don't want to just know what you're feeling. I want to know which each part of you is feeling. And so angry self will always say, well, I was furious. I wanted to. So I had a patient. Lovely borderline she was. She said, oh yeah, angry self, that's my real self, angry self. I wouldn't want to lose angry self, she said. I wouldn't want to lose angry self. She said, I'll tell you an example. The other day, somebody cut me up on the road. So I went on the other side of the street just so I could get alongside them and go, wah! This woman is dangerous, right? So she goes, so okay, that's angry self, right? Was there any other self in that thing? No. What about anxious self? Were you anxious about what you were doing? No. Well, let's think about it. Supposing you were anxious. Supposing you were. I know you weren't, and you'd be absolutely amazed how often this question works. But just supposing you were, what would anxious self be thinking? And she said, well, I suppose anxious self would be thinking, oh, shit, I'm out of control. So just getting them to shift. I know you're not anxious, you don't do anxiety. I mean, hell, anxiety is for wimps. But if you were anxious, it's amazing how often that works. If you were sad, I know you're not sad, but if you did do sadness. So this is kind of very interesting way of working, of actually helping people get to know these different aspects of self. Right, so the thing is, you've now discovered there's different aspects of self. They have different thoughts, different feelings, different emotions, different memories. They want to do different things, and they fight with each other. They conflict with each other. In depressed people, there can be a fear of sadness, particularly if it slips into depression. Sometimes patients say, if I let myself go too much into sadness, I will collapse and I'll kill myself, because it'll be overwhelming to me. Or if I get too much into anger, I'll kill myself. So they get very quite frightened about these different states of mind. Okay, so the next thing we're going to do is, which stuff are we going to go into now?
Compassion.
Yes, you got it already. You know all this. So see, you can fire me now because you know it all. Right, okay, so what we do, of course, is to prepare to bring compassion to self. So firstly, we slow the breath. Always use the physical things to slow the breath. To remind you now of your body centeredness, the point of stillness within you. To remind you of your wisdom. Life is tough, right? Conflicts are everywhere, all the time humans are in conflicts. It's nobody's fault, it's what we are. Just want to be helpful, really. Not submissive, but given there is a conflict, which you didn't really want, just want to be helpful. Bring your voice tone and your facial expression. Okay, so now, what do you think about this argument? When you come back, pull back to your wisdom, pull back to slowing down, come back to the self you actually want to be. How do you see it? And of course, we know a little bit about the body because we've been slowing. So, what do you want to do? And what memories come to you? Okay, so what did you notice? What did you notice? Did you notice anything?
When I was thinking from the compassion itself, I actually thought about all of the different emotions on how I was thinking that I was angry and scared and all these things at the same time in that arc.
So your compassion self can see this, right? Okay, so what you might have noted, putting words in your mouth probably, is that compassion self is much more likely to be empathic and mentalized, okay? And if it isn't, then we train the patient. So compassion self can think, well, there's two of us in the argument and maybe they were feeling upset because. So compassion self starts the process of mentalizing. Angry self won't mentalize, I don't give a shit what you think, all right? Angry self won't empathize, compassionate self will. Anxious self is usually too frightened, or if it does empathize, it's very submissive. I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to upset you. Please don't be hurtful. Don't say nasty things to me. Compassionate self has the capacity to stand back because you slow the mind and to start thinking, actually, maybe both of us were involved here or whatever, or that person was very upset, or they were very tired, or perhaps I pushed one of the threat buttons or whatever. So compassionate self has a way of thinking about the problem that's different from the other two. The other two will just go vroom. They're automatic vroom. They'll always think the same thing vroom. Compassion self, on the other hand, slows the process down and gives you an opportunity to think. And compassion self will start thinking, okay, so what's the way to resolve this? Now, the key thing that I hope you've recognized inside of yourself is that you have this wisdom. I didn't tell you this. You've discovered it for yourself. It's in you. This inner wisdom is there if you create space for it. And to create space for it, you have to step aside of the threat self, because threatened self will turn up with angry and anxious and all that, and then they'll fight with each other and all that. There's nothing abnormal about that. It's not your fault, but it's the way it is. It's the way it works, right? The other thing is, as Lynn was saying, what is your view of the other selves? Compassion self, when you look out at anxious self and angry self, what do you feel about them? Yeah, it's like a parent with these kids squabbling, isn't it? The more you practice, because this becomes your inner authority. This is the point of stability. And you see all these parts. Oh, well, I can understand why I'm angry and I can understand why I'm anxious. And I can see all the memories and the reasons why that goes off. But this is the self I want to be. This is the self I want to bring to the party. And the more you practice that, the more you realize there are multiples, you're multiple. The more you realize that in certain situations, anxious self or angry self are going to turn up without you asking them. They'll just be there. You're in it before you even can think, You go to the airport, this is my favorite, when you go to the airport and you suddenly realize there's a bloody queue and you don't know if you're going to get through in time to catch your flight, and you're thinking, these bastards, honestly, I'm paying so much for this ticket that I can't even sort my cues out. So angry self turns up immediately when I'm under time pressure. Because I have to slow down. Okay, so that's important. That's a little bit of an insight into how we do a movement around the three circles by looking at the different aspects of the threat system. And then we step out of the red into the green to bring the compassion system to actually do the work. And so we're not actually teaching people to challenge their thoughts particularly, although they might want to do that, but just that the compassion self always has a different perspective, usually. And if it doesn't, then we train people. Okay, so the next exercise I'm going to do with you, thank you very much, is look at your self-criticism. So what we're going to do now is to I think my microphone's gone off, never mind. What we're going to do now is to look at self-criticism. And the first thing I'm going to do with you is called function analysis. Now, are you all familiar with function analysis? Do you know what function analysis is? Well, function analysis is a behavioral thing, and basically all it is understanding the functions behind a belief, a behavior, or whatever. So two people go to the hospital having taken an overdose. One person wants to kill themselves, the other person was drunk and lost how many count, how many tablets they took for a hangover. Okay, same behavior, you need to wash them out, and they both end up in hospital and overdose, but very different functions. Okay, it's the same with self-criticism. Self-criticism has very different functions. And so when we're going to work with shame and self-criticism, we have to understand the... We've probably run out of battery, have we? So we have to understand functions. Now, there are different ways of understanding functions. You can understand positive functions, but it's also quite interesting to do is to take it away and find out what people feel they would lose if you take it away. So this is function analysis on self-criticism. Okay, so I want you to imagine that this is a very magical workshop. Well, exactly. You don't need to imagine, do you? I mean, there we are. So it's a very magical question. And as a result of this, we're going to take away your self-criticism so you will never be angry or shaming or put yourself down again. You'll never beat yourself up for anything. What would you be frightened of? What would be your greatest fear if I could do that for you this afternoon?
Someone else doing it first.
Okay. Okay, it's a bit too big, that. Okay, yeah. Anything else?
Become lazy. Be a jerk to other people. Prideful, as in full of pride. Haha, right. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I've got to try and reduce the I'll find out how to do it. But anyway, so far then we've got the following. If I don't put myself down, somebody else will do it. I'll become lazy, I'll be a jerk to other people, I'll be unmotivated, people won't like me, I'll be selfish and prideful. So you don't really want to give it up, do you? No, you don't, see. Okay, so here's the challenge that I said I would take this afternoon for you. Okay, to show you that you are all deluded. Now, this is exactly what I do with my group. We do it very playfully, right? Because they say all these things as well. But you're wrong. There's no question about this. You are simply wrong. That's it. Okay, so can I take the challenge?
Uh-huh.
All right, great. I'm glad you said that. Okay. Okay, so we're going to do a little imagery task. So prepare for the imagery by doing the breath. Okay, so now I would like you to think of something you don't like very much about yourself. And then you criticize yourself for. Okay, so the next thing of it is to imagine you can see the critic outside of you. You take it out of your head and look at it. And look at it criticizing you, saying the things that it says to you. What does it look like? What emotions is it directing at you? What does it really feel about you? Okay, now switch perspectives and just look within. How are you feeling now? Okay, just make a note of that. My computer's gone bizarre. Just make a note of that. All right, so what did you see? It's decided to put a header in. I don't know how to get rid of it. Does anyone know how to get rid of these headers? Close header. Oh, well. Thank you so much. See, it's amazing what you can see from a different perspective. Right. Thank you. Okay, so here we go. So what does your critic look like? So big. Yeah, anything else? Angry. So that's the feelings it's directing at you, yeah?
It looks like me.
What kind of you?
Blurry.
Blurry you, okay. Was it happy you or joyful you? Angry you, okay. So angry me.
That weird mustache.
I deny all responsibility. Okay, so it's got a mustache. Okay. That's not how you spell it, is it? Come on, how do you spell this? Mustache. Okay. Anything else?
There's like a giant
pointy finger. Okay, we could go on. Thank you. Okay, so what emotions was it directing at you? Shame on you. Yeah. Anything else? Sorry?
Contempt.
Oh, that's a good one, isn't it? Okay, so here's the deal then. Which I love this bit. So you told me that you were going to be lazy, you'd be a jerk around people, you'd be unmotivated, people would dislike you, and you'd be selfish and prideful. And so we said, okay, this critic is protecting you from all that, keeping you on the straight and narrow, but look at this. When you look at it, it's big, angry, loud, ugly, disgusted. It's got an angry mustache. It's got a pointed finger. It feels disgust and disappointment, shame and contempt for you. Does it really have your best interests at heart? Does it take pleasure when you do well? Does it encourage you? No, not really. Okay, so we do this with our groups, and the point is that people recognize that actually the critical self is more likely to beat them down. They're going to feel worse. So how did you feel then when you listened to your critic? How did you feel?
Crappy.
Absolutely, so you felt really crappy. Okay, so this is important then. Because, I've got to get onto that, haven't I? Yeah. Because
The fact of the matter is that your compassionate self is the self that will help you. All right? Your compassionate self is the self that wants to see you do well. And the tragedy is, you know this. Right? If you have a child you love, and you take them to a school, and you go to one school, and in this school, there's a teacher that looks a little angry with a mustache and says, give me your child and we will ensure that your child is never lazy, is not prideful, all that stuff. Because what we will do is we will be angry with them if they are. If they make mistakes, we'll show contempt. All right. Okay, we'll be disgusted with them. That child will learn. You learn. You must never be prideful. You must never be lazy. Give me your child. Or you could go to another school and they say, give us your child, and we will do what we can encourage them to take joy in their work. Okay? If they make mistakes, they'll seek help to change and develop and grow. Okay? So who are you going to send your child to? Right? It's a no-brainer. Now the tragedy is, right, the great tragedy is that of course all of us like to be lazy from time to time. That's absolutely true. And some of us can be a jerk and some of us can be unmotivated from time to time. But the reason that you're studying, doing what you're doing, is because of your goodness. Because you want to help people. Not because you're frightened of being a jerk. Not because you're frightened of being lazy and you need to be beaten with contempt and anger and pointy fingers. That's not why you're here. And the problem is people actually believe this crap, that they need all this stuff going on in their head, otherwise they'd be no good people. No, you don't. What you need to do is to be in contact with what it is that turns you on. The reason I work quite hard, and I think I do, is because I love it. I love it. It's wonderful. Being here with you is a wonderful opportunity. It's a great privilege because I can have fun and talk to you about my work, sell a few books maybe. Okay, I don't need a critic. If I have a critic, it's because I probably do too much and ignore my poor beloved wife. But the key thing is, of course, you're going to criticize yourself from time to time, but that's a default position that really you don't want to hang on to. You don't want to see the benefits of it. You're going to do it, because we all do, right? But the compassionate self is the self that will guide you. Because in reality, most humans, most of the time, not all the time, sometimes it's good to be lazy, sometimes we're all a bit of a jerk, but most of the time, you don't want to be that. You want to be at your best. You want to be the best therapist you can be. You want to get the best marks you can get. You want to help as many people as you can. Just talking with Ricardo and the enthusiasm he has for spreading this to as many people as we can, that's from the heart. That's the energy you want, not the energy of, well, if you don't do this, you're a jerk. It's fantastic, right? So I don't know whether I won the bet or not, but the point about it is the more you align to your compassionate self and find what in ACT talks about your core values, the more you'll become excited about doing things. And when you make mistakes, and you will, you'll turn to others for help. So this is really important, learning to be open, that you're all on a journey right now, okay? You're beginning. Most of you, not all of you, many of you, some of you are very senior people, but for the younger ones, you're beginning. And the ability for you to be honest about the things you don't know and turn to others for help, that's the compassion itself all the time. Okay, so as we come to the end now, a couple more things to do. And that is working with the issues of learning how to focus on compassion. Okay, so where am I going now? So one of the other things we're going to do is called compassionate letter writing. Okay, now compassionate letter writing is great fun. Now a colleague of mine just down, I don't know your name, I'm sorry, but he was talking about he went to a yoga thing, and they had to write it with a non-dominant hand. So I've never done that, but anyway. So what we're going to do is bring to mind a problem that you have with your life at the moment. Nothing too serious, okay? Like you're divorcing and overcoming major drug addiction. You won't. That's a little heavy. But something that's reasonably, not too bad, but is a little bit of a problem. And we're going to write to ourselves a compassionate letter. And what we're going to do, before we write, we'll take the breath, we'll slow down, we'll get into the self that we want to be. And we're going to spend just 3 minutes, okay, because it takes a while, this is coming to the end of the workshop in the not too distant future, just doing 3 or 4 minutes, writing to ourselves in a compassionate way, okay? And doesn't matter what you write, just try and write to yourself with a very validating, understanding, compassionate tone in your writing, okay? Okay, so off we go then. Okie dokie. So, what did you notice as you were writing? Okay, great.
Empowered.
Okay, so what I hope you've noticed when we've done multiple selves and with your critic, right? We're going to do another thing with your critic in a minute, is that if you just begin to shift your mind by regulating your attention, focusing on the breath, the body experience, and your intentionality on purpose, right? You actually produce some interesting changes. You can actually write to yourself in a way that empowers you or validates you or helps you. And in therapy, sometimes we read the letters to the patient. They give us the letter, we read it to them and so on. Sometimes you have to guide them because some patients are not very compassionate. Interestingly, ones that have come from cognitive therapy, I love cognitive therapy, I was the president of it. They get them to write letters, they say things like, you know, if it was me writing the letter, it would be, you know, dear Paul, you know, you went to the party the other day and John ignored you, and you were really upset about that, and it's really understandable because he was a friend of yours. However, as you know, you tend to be a black and white thinker and you tend to kind of personalize these things when you don't need to personalize these things. So there we go. So, all right. So the point about it is what you're learning is then that just shifting. These are the three systems. You can deliberately start shifting them, getting people to learn how to shift in them. Okay, so here's another thing we're going to do. We're going to start to work with the critic a little bit. Again, using compassionate self. And so what we're going to do here is do a little imagery and show you how this works. Okay? So, again, be prepared for the imagery. Always respect the practice. Clear the mind as best you can by slowing the breath and focusing on the body, even if you just do it for 20 seconds or something. Tell them you'll be back for tea very soon. It's all right, don't worry. Okay, so reconnect to compassionate self. This is the self you want to be. This is the self that has wisdom. This is your inner authority. This is the self that's committed to be helpful. Okay, and now see once again that part of you that is critical. A pointy-fingered, angry, mustachy kind of person. And watch them criticizing you. But this time, to stay with your compassionate position, feeling the point of stillness in your body, that strength. And just wishing for them compassion, okay? So the mantra is that which is causing you to have this anger or this contempt or whatever, that which is causing you to criticize me in this way, May that cease, and may you find peace. Okay? Because compassionate self can see underneath the critic. Behind the critic might be fear of rejection or disappointment. That the criticism in itself is a response to threat. The compassionate self has the wisdom to see that. So the compassionate self sees the critic. May that which is causing you to attack me in this way, to be so angry with me, to be disappointed in me, may you find peace. May you settle. And just notice what happens when you do that. Okay, well done. Let's come back together for a little bit. Okay. What did you notice? Grounded. Sorry?
Yes, grounded.
You felt more grounded?
Yes, felt grounded in the compassionate self.
Right. Okay, so the key thing then is that there will be a part of you that gets frustrated and angry, right? And in behavioral terms, we make a distinction between behavioral self-blame and global self-blame. This is an old distinction we made many years. And of course, you're going to be disappointed with yourself when you make mistakes, right? So I tell my patients, one day I was tired and I drove home, long, long clinic, and it was late at night, and I missed my drive, so I managed to bang into my garden wall. So bashed in the front of my car and knocked my wall over. Now, very clearly, that is my fault, nobody else. I mean, God didn't grab the steering wheel and say, well, there we go. That was me. But it's behavioral, right? And obviously I'm going to be frustrated at that point. But the key thing is noticing that and the desire to settle down as quickly as you can. Because if I then go into the house with my wife and children storming about, I just create a bad atmosphere for them, you know. So I don't want to be like that. So always holding to this, I don't want to be like that, I don't want to be like that. This is the self I want to be, so I learn how to contain my own stuff, right? In this particular case, I was quite a young man, and I didn't do it very well, and I went home and said, knock that, knock down that fucking wall. So, it was, but I'm better, I've improved. But the key thing is recognizing that actually with your patients, right, most of them have global self-attacking, the sense of the self as being bad or useless or no good or whatever it is, and that's different from just blaming your behavior. And that's the kind of criticism you want to get at. And this is an important thing. Now, in some forms of therapy, I won't say which ones, but they will engage in conflict with the critic, arguing with the critic, or even shooting the critic, right? Now, in our approach, that's a very bad idea because you're staying in the threat system. You don't want to stay in the threat system. You need to get into the green system, always out of the red, into the green, out of the red, always into the green, sometimes into the blue for achievement and doing, that's important too. But where you need to shift the system, because the system, the green system, is biologically set up to downregulate the threat system. So I'm going to try and give you an example of this once more, personal example. So we're going to imagine then that you have a therapist who comes to see you, and this therapist says to you, you're a therapist and they're a therapist, I'm getting really depressed. And I'm depressed because I'm not getting very good results. Can you see this at the back? Is this okay? Because it's a bit small, this writing. Okay, good. It's on your file as well. And they say, I'm getting poor results in my patients. Let me just see if I can change the focus and that looks a bit blurred. Okay, they're getting poor results of the patients, and the external shame is that, so the idea, remember, external shame is what you think others think about you, and this person's think, that's better, that's much better, thank you. Others will wonder what I'm doing, others will be critical of me, they'll see that I'm not getting a very good response, and then they'll think I'm not competent, and they'll want to disconnect from me, they won't want to send their patients to me. And then I'll get a reputation of being a crap therapist. You know. And you know, when I think about it, when I turn the intention inwards, it turns out that I think, well, maybe I should be getting better results. Maybe my patients would do better with somebody else. Have you ever had that thought? Yeah. Maybe I don't know enough. Maybe I'm incompetent. Do you ever have those thoughts? Not often, I'm sure, because this is, after all, California. But sometimes we do. Okay, so the point is we can then begin to work cognitively with this. So the first thing is developing empathy for one's own distress, of course. So that's acceptance, understandable to feel disappointed and thwarted. Understand the functions and origins of the self-criticism. What is the inner bully frightened of? Well, the inner bully is usually frightened of this. Rejection, disconnection, being disregarded, that's normally what the fear is, so we understand that. And then we can look at compassionate attention. And compassionate attention, remember, is switching your focus to what you can do rather than what you can't, okay? And bring into memory times when you've been successful. So let's do this right now, okay? For those of you who are therapists, close your mind. It's getting late, I'm so sorry. Close your eyes and just remember a time of a good encounter with a patient, how they were pleased with what you had done or what you did together and the feeling good you had together. See their facial expressions. Okay, so what happened for you when you did that? Yeah, so when you deliberately switch your attention from here to here, it changes, right? Remember that holidays versus the army? So attention is voluntary. You can put your attention wherever you want to, right? And this is a good cognitive intervention. Pay attention to the things that are helpful to you, right? And then you can have some cognitive compassionate thoughts, right? So that you can focus on what is helpful. So the ability to be with patients and listening, bear their feelings, actually that can be quite helpful to patients. There's quite a lot of evidence that the ability just to be with them, even if there's not much you can do, without rushing around trying to do loads of things, that's helpful. Not black and white thinking, you know? So I'll learn more as I gain experience, but this does not make me incompetent, okay? Acceptance of limitation. I'd like to see progress, but I'll only do my best. That's all I can do. Now, many years ago, I had a training supervisor, it was a lovely supervisor, she was psychodynamic, because I've done quite a lot of psychodynamic training as well, and I disqualified, and I was working in the National Health Service, and we had some really difficult patients, cutters and people who wanted to hang themselves and things. So I went to my supervisor, and I said, look, Kitty, because that was their name, so I used to call that. I said, listen, Kitty, these patients, I really don't know what the hell I'm doing. You know, I've only been qualified a couple of weeks, and I just think they'd do so much better with somebody else. Couldn't they see you or something? And, of course, she had massive long lists, you know, waiting lists. And so she looked at me. She used to smoke these French cigarettes. She was had a slightly French accent. She's lovely, absolutely superb. She's in her 80s now. She said, well, the thing is, Paul, she said, you see, we'd all do better with the fried. Okay, yeah, with Freud would be good with these patients, I'm sure. But unfortunately, he's dead. So we will have to do without him. And she then, we had a long discussion about this whole business of accepting limitations. We can only be what we are. And what she basically said was, if you have 3 months of training, or post 3 months, you've been trained for 3 months, then be the best 3 month trained therapist you can be. That's all you can do. You can't offer any more. You can't have 20 years experience in 3 months. You simply cannot. And in 20 years, you may well be a better therapist, but not today. And the point is, if you're sitting in therapy thinking, if only they could see somebody else, if only I knew more, if only this, if only, you will not be with them in the moment. Now, she didn't use quite that language, but it was close to that language. You won't be with them with their suffering, I think, what was that she said. So this is us, you see. Accept that we are where we are. And not always wanting more. Well, it's natural to want more. Of course you want to be the best therapist you can. But if you can accept the fact that you don't know, there's so many things you don't know, because that is the way life is. When you start, you don't know. And wisdom comes when you realize, actually, there's more and more I don't know. You realize what you don't know, not what you do. And that's the beginning of wisdom. So I haven't got a clue. And the other thing, of course, is this common humanity issue of recognizing that all of us struggle with patience. This is hard work, you know, dealing with the suffering in other people's minds. It is emotionally tricky. It's difficult. We are allowing our minds to be affected by the pain and suffering, sometimes horrible pain and suffering, of the minds of others. And it's important, if you're a therapist, to always stay open to supervision. Don't close down, okay? The trainees are the tricky ones, are the ones that are frightened to come with a problem. They're the ones that always want to tell you how well they're doing. Well, that's great, but I don't need to know about that. It's wonderful, and I'm happy to reward them and say how super. But can they come and tell me, you know, Paul, because they don't call me Dr. Gilbert in England, they just call me Paul. Poor, I just really cocked up on this patient, you know. I just kind of completely missed the point. That's what I want to know. Because that's then we can talk about that, all right? It's like if you go and learn tennis, right? You want your coach to tell you where you're going wrong. How am I doing it? Show me. You don't want them to keep saying, oh, your backhand is fantastic, well, you keep hitting the net all the time. I mean, you clearly know it's not. Just because they want to make you feel good. So this is important of creating an opportunity with your supervisors to always seek out others who can help you. All right? And that's the compassionate position. The shame position is to close down. I don't want to tell anybody. I don't want people to know I'm struggling. I don't want people to know I don't know this. That's the shame position. The compassion system is, I haven't got a clue. Who has? Does anybody have a clue? Can you help me? And that then makes it easier for you. Okay, so here's a little thing. I want you to read this through and rate it out of 10, how helpful it is, and keep the rating in your mind. Okay? Don't tell me what it is. Don't worry, I'm not going to do the magic thing, I'm going to guess or anything like that. Just hold it in your mind. All right? You got a rating for it? Out of 10, how helpful it is? Okay? All right, so here's the thing then. So now breathe slowly, slow your breath. Remember, you are a compassionate person, right? You have a great wisdom. You understand this is very difficult stuff. And now I want you to read this through, but don't worry about whether you believe it or not. Don't look at it as what's the evidence. Just focus on as much warmth and as kindness in the words. Focus on the emotional tone of your reading. Slowly read it. Read it slowly, focusing on the warmth of your reading. Okay, so what did you notice? What happened to your ratings of helpfulness? They went up. Did most people agree? Sort of. Okay, so what's the deal then? I mean, we've taken the basic cognitive stuff, great stuff, and that was helpful to a degree. But look what happens when you deliberately, on purpose, stimulate the green system and then do the stuff, right? Then it starts to bite. Why? It's because that system is designed to downregulate the threat system. When you get into that system, it will help you. You still need this stuff. You still need to stand back and look at it in a more balanced perspective way. It still helps you to recognize these things. This insight, this wisdom is important, but If you bring in the green system as well, now it really starts to bite, and you actually find you believe it more. You don't need more evidence. Get the affect system going. Okay, so I'm going to now show you a video of a person talking about the end of therapy. And this brings up quite a lot of issues to do with CFT, and it's one of my, I like this video. Now, this was a lady who came to me with quite a severe problem. She was a multiple suicide. The hospital was getting really, didn't know what to do with her because she kept running off and trying to take overdoses. She was a cutter. And the psychiatrist said to me, look, see what you can do, Paul, because I don't think we're going to keep her alive for another 6 months. She was really quite bad. And in other parts of the video, which you don't have time to show today, she talks about a lot of this stuff of wanting to kill herself. Jotun's heard it, so he will tell you about that. Anyhow, so, but we spent 2.5 years with her. She'd had a lot of therapy before, psychotherapy, psychodynamic therapy, cognitive therapy, and in and out of hospital. So she had about 7 years, really, of therapy before she even came to see me. So, as I say, they used to send me the really tricky cases. So there we were. So we did some compassion-focused therapy with her, and she has done incredibly well, and she hasn't had any major depression now in nearly, well, 15 years, 20 years, actually. She's got 6 grandchildren, and it's amazing. So let me just show you her.
Okay, now we can kind of move slightly from the external. We thought that.
Okay, so as you see, I'm quite young there. It's always very sad for me to see this. Okay, so we'd been talking in a previous part of the interview about her shame. Oh, I don't think I want this one, in fact. That's the wrong one. Sorry, I don't want that. That's her self-criticism and self-attacking, so we're not going to look at that today. This is the one we want to look at.
Then you've also said that the writing down.
So this is beginning with the cognitive stuff that we were doing with her, and how we then. I used to wear glasses in those days, but I've had cataracts, so I don't need them now. Okay, here we go.
So how was that? How did that help you?
That again took a long time because it was quite hard to be logical, and I'm not terribly logical in most of the time.
So that's a classic cognitive therapy thing. I could do all the alternatives, I write them all down, they're all very logical, could see all the evidence, blah, 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 right? But it didn't mean anything. So I couldn't get her to understand this.
And the bit I found most difficult was the bit where you'd say, what would a friend say? I would never put myself in that position because the critical self would come back.
Never do it. I can't put myself in my position because the critical self would say, don't be stupid.
I would be upset if you don't do that. So that was very difficult. Very, very difficult.
So you had to identify your negative.
I could identify, I knew.
See the cycle,
yeah.
See the circles.
Yes. I could logically write down what the outcome would be.
You could put some challenges down.
I didn't mean it. It was all a mind game. Wasn't an emotion game, and that was the difference.
Okay. And it was during this time, really actually, I started to work with compassionate mind work,
yes,
to help people. We kind of look at that now. To help people. Because we did things like behavioral planning and scheduling and all that stuff, and planning the day, which I'm not going to talk about. But then to try to work with this experience of challenging. The emotion and the emotional challenge starts to develop compassionate mind, which was helping you become sensitive to your own distress, because you often, when you were distressed, you often just would hate yourself. Yes, so that was the thing. So just helping to be sensitive and gentle with their own distress, because she'd hate it, you know, she'd get in and say, I hate myself, and I'm like this, I hate being depressed, cut myself, right? So just being holding her distress was part of what we're doing.
You
felt depression, hate yourself, being stressed.
Yeah.
It was very difficult for you to be empathic to your pain.
I could do it for other people, but not for myself.
So how did it feel then when we started to try to have it become sad? She was sad.
So this is important. We started to do confession. She said, this is complete bullshit. I'm not doing that.
Hey, no,
that was weak. That was
she's being gentle here, but she's very tough.
I think I'm about to turn from it. It's a bit wet. It's a bit weak. You know, where's this coming from? There must be some firmer that we could use.
Yes. Can I force you into jail?
Yeah, exactly.
Beat you in jail.
She said, can't you beat me to believe this?
So that came of the ability to grieve for the abandonment.
There's a little bit of a story for this. Then she was adopted at 9 months old, and we're not quite sure what happened before, but could be not very nice things. But she had an idealized biological mother, and the family she was adopted into was very rigid, and they used to expect very high standards of her, a lot of emotional control, and they used to beat her quite a lot and send her to her room. And she told me when we got into this grieving stuff, and interestingly, no one had gone into grief with her. Oh, that therapy, she'd never done grief work, which is, I find amazing. But anyway, so she'd lay on the bed when her mother had beaten her with a brush, and she, through her tears, she'd watch the stars, and she'd imagine her mother coming in a chariot to come and get her and take her away. She'd call her Fairy Princess Mother. And so this was incredible stuff. And so she was crying, I was crying, the secretary down the hall was crying, the gardener listening outside the window, oh my God, it's so sad. So everybody was, we were all crying. So this was quite a phenomenal, very emotional stuff.
For the loss of your biological mother, for the life that you might have had, the mother that you didn't want rather than to remember, your princess mother, okay, that was kind of the grieving process.
Yes.
And that we did find quite difficult as well.
Yes, you see, when my adopted father died, I was sad and I missed him. I didn't know how to.
Didn't know how to grieve, I didn't know.
That's just part of my life.
She was very contemptuous of other people who were grieving at the funeral. Stupid. Losing control. Stupid. Why are they just crying? What's the God? Put yourself together. That was her view.
As well as for my mum. I don't care, it's too big a matter. I've never grieved. I have never grieved properly for anybody who's done.
So how did that feel when you started to kind of work with that, those feelings?
It's very emotional. I think I'll do tears every session. You
started to cry?
Yes. Yeah, I did. It was touching part of me that I don't think I knew.
Now, if I could tell you the number of borderlines that have said that to me when they're in the middle of a grief process, I didn't know I felt this much pain. I didn't know that. I didn't know that. So she was although she was borderline, she was this depressive cutter, and she was very angry, actually. But didn't know it, you see. She'd been totally dissociated from these emotions, totally dissociated from grief, even when her father died. And these patients talk about actually free, they're in a state of frozenness. And when they start grieving, and it's like the lights come on, it's like things become technicolored for them. That's how they describe it. I'm beginning to feel things and subtleties of feelings that I never knew I had.
The grief and sadness existed in me. I've never tapped into it.
So that was the beginning, wasn't it?
Yes.
Empathic to your own distress.
Yes.
The struggle that we had in the life, and the real fight to be accepted, to not be abandoned, the sad part of you. Was there any shame about the crying in the beginning? Were you ashamed of being tearful and acknowledging this
part? I used to get angry because I was tearful so much. I used to think you just get really fed up with this woman who comes in here and cries buckets every week. No, I don't think I was. It wasn't shaming like the shame I experienced. Yeah, it was that sort of shame. God, here we go again. And I used to come in and think, I'm not going to cry this week. And I didn't. That would happen. Yeah. Never mind. He's used to it now. So no.
So again.
You didn't make me feel ashamed.
So this is quite important with grief process and borderlines. It takes a time, you know. You can't rush it. You just got to allow it to happen.
You're handing the tissue.
I used to worry that I'd become a discriminative stimulus for tearfulness, because she'd come from the waiting room and she'd smile at me. She'd sit in the chair, she'd take one look at me and then go,
So, do you think that was an important part of your recovery, the healing process, to be in touch with them?
Yes. I think the anger was the first thing, recognizing the inner emotions.
Yeah.
Well, again, it's yet another inner emotion that I haven't recognized. So, you've got the anger on the side and the sadness on the other. And until I'd learned both of them, I couldn't get better. Couldn't.
Okay, and I think that captures key issues really in working with the affect and components within the cognitive approach. So the next part was to take some of your challenges.
This is what we were doing originally.
Challenge your negative thinking. And yes. Then to imagine a compassionate part.
So this is just what we did just now, right? This is what we did. This is how it all began. Just doing this, warming up cognitive therapy. That's what we did to start with.
You challenge it.
Then use that way.
How to personify it? Because I couldn't do any of them. And I came up because I've lived in a Buddhist commune for a while. And Buddhism, it's, if I'm going to be religious, it would be Buddhism for me. Anyway, it's a mixture of sort of pagan and Buddhism religion. The pagan is the Earth Mother, which is what my dog set out to be. In the 60s, and you got Earth Mothers by the tongue, but it was a combination of the two. Perhaps it's a gender thing, a bit of the male god and the female blending together with the two of the guys.
So then you would fantasize.
This was very interesting because this is an example of the wisdom of your patient. Because we were trying to help her become compassionate self, right? She didn't want to do that. So she was the one that came up with the idea of compassionate image. And looking back at the case, obviously, because her parenting had been so bad. So she needed to create this internal object, right? So fantastic wisdom. And as she says, it was a kind of combination of the feminine and the masculine, which I thought was really amazing. Patients have a lot of wisdom if you let them let it emerge.
Yeah, I certainly couldn't picture of Buddha dresses as an elf goddess. No, but it was cross-dressing.
This was your inner compassion.
Yeah, but it was a feeling of warmth.
Right.
It came out as the essence of warmth. And I can't give it another.
So she never actually saw it. She could describe it, but she never saw it. And that's why we talk so much about don't try and over-visualize if you can't. It's the essence, it's the sense of. What you're getting is a sense of. And so she had a sense of this Buddha image that came with a lot of warmth.
Then I've tried to think of picturesque, if you like, and I can't come up with anything other than warmth. Comfort, perhaps.
And you had to work quite hard to begin to develop that, because I remember in the early days when you were trying to help you develop a warm challenge, your challenges were often quite cold, almost critical.
Yes.
You know, pull yourself together. It's very difficult.
Just slip into it, wouldn't I?
See, that's the thing, you know, when they're trying to be too alternative or perspective taking, it was always harsh, harsh, harsh. The tone, the emotional harsh was always very harsh.
I tried so hard, but I couldn't get there.
You try very hard. The logic was funny, but it was always the affect, it was always,
yes.
Yeah. This is absolutistic, you know, this is black and white thinking, you don't need to think about it.
That's wrong.
Stop. Okay. So getting some warmth into your challenge was great, but that took quite a while for you to begin to feel warmth.
Yes.
Feel things.
I mean, that's fairly recent. It's fairly recent.
And you're still working.
I'm still working on it.
Okay, so how is it going?
Well, put it this way, I'm not going back. I don't think there's any way, after what I've learned over the last 7 years, that I can go back to the depressed person that I was. I now can recognise the triggers, or recognise when the trigger has been triggered, and do something about it. Say, okay, you're feeling angry, you're feeling critical, you said something stupid, you regret it, But I can deal with it. I can deal with it now. I say, okay, yeah, it was a stupid thing to say. It's going to be forgotten soon. The warmth comes in.
Switch.
Hey, it's just
out of the red into the green.
Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody does silly things. Nobody's going to condemn me for it. And I used to condemn. I condemned myself too much.
That's a good thought.
In a condemnation. I'm not going back to that. However many years I still got problems with. I still reach for the travel lights at some point. But
occasionally when you come and we work with you, and you're much more attached with sadness. You can flip into sadness quite easily.
Yes.
And look at your thinking.
Yes. It just needs more practice. I'm going to spend most of the time working with depression, not half a mania.
Yes.
So I need the same length of time to practice for that one.
Yes. And half a mania is better.
You can self-medicate.
I do for one, yes.
So the book of Passion Mind, you found quite a, as I understand, a major factor of being able to use the cognitive approach of developing symptoms, and you're still practicing that. And it helps you become more accepting. And when things go wrong for you, it stops the condemning. It gives you different emotions.
You switch out of the red into the green, out of the red into the green. If you can't get into the green because you never experienced it, you haven't got emotional memories, blah, 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 then it's very difficult. You're just stuck in the red, you know. It's like Eric Tronick said right at the beginning, you get in and you can't get out. There's no way out unless you've got some green. This is how we would see it.
Content.
Never thought I'd able to say that. I'm content. And so finally then, how do you see yourself as the way you come out?
So there you go. And that, of course, is the green system, contentment. To be at peace with oneself, right? That's it. So she taught me a lot. She used to phone me up in a clinic, my busy clinic on a Tuesday morning, to say things like, Paul, I know you're trying to help me and you've been great and everything, but I can't go on with this life. I have the knife. I've decided today's the day. Goodbye. Oh my God. So you phone up the GP, police would go and try and find her. We found her once out on the borders of Derbyshire. Dear, dear. But anyway, the point is that even for these poor souls, they're in torment, really, absolute torment. If you get some warmth into the system, they do amazing things. Okay, that's the trick, though, and it's not easy. Okay, so we're going to do one last meditation, and then we will finish for the day. Okay. Now, this is a Christian Neff, and this is something that Beatum asked me to do for you. This is a Christian Neff and Chris Germer little thing, which is rather nice to look after ourselves. There are a couple of things you should always remember with patients. Okay, be open to possibilities of misunderstanding, but never blame yourself. Okay? I'll give you an example. A young therapist that we're training up recently did a very good formulation with the patient. The patient comes back the following week and says, you know that formulation you did, it really upset me. It's made me upset for the whole week. And the therapist comes to supervision and says, oh dear, I think I must have gone too quickly and done too much, right? So he said to the therapist, well, is this the style of this guy? Does he do this with other people, always blame them for upsetting him? And he said, oh yeah, his wife is always upsetting him. It's always somebody else that upsets him. So whatever you do to this guy, anything that upsets him, it's your fault, right? Now, if the therapist buys that, then they're buying into the problem, right? Because in fact, the formulation that this guy did was fantastic, actually. But the trainee therapist couldn't hold his own goodness and got blown off because he got caught up in the patient's externalizing. So always be careful about how you blame yourself, right, in the therapy. Be open, you're not going to be perfect, you will make mistakes, but just be careful. So you have to survive your patients before you can treat them, particularly borderlines, because they will go for you if they find an Achilles heel. Okay, so here we go. So what we're going to do then is just bring our compassionate self to the table, to the chair, and think of a thing that you find difficult, maybe in therapy or whatever. maybe a problem you have in your life. Okay, and then put your hand just over your heart, your right hand over your heart. Just off, you know, about half an inch or an inch off. And then recognize, this is a moment of suffering in my life. And then, suffering is universal. So this is common humanity. Suffering is part of this life, all right? So just say, suffering is universal. May I be compassionate to this time of my own suffering. So this is a moment of suffering in my life. Suffering is universal, it's the human condition. May I be compassionate with my own suffering. Okay, and finally then, we make a commitment that as best as I am able, I will try to allow the compassion itself to live through me day on day. As far as I'm able, I will try to let the compassion itself live through me. In other words, I will try to let this part of my being, this part of my potential, this version of me, live more in the life that I have, to become more part of the life that I have. Angry self, of course, will always turn up, and anxious self will turn up, and all these other selves, they all want to be part of the act too, but I'm going to commit myself as much as I can to let the compassionate self become the dominant self in my life. And wouldn't that be fun? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, the workshop is at an end. Thank you so much.